It's 11:30 sharp, and welcome back to the last set of presentations this morning. Before, we will have some great insights for you from customers with real-world skilling examples in the session at 12:15. We will start with Joris Falconet, and in his current role as data and AI specialist for Shell at Microsoft, Joris is passionate about data and AI, and with over 10 years of experience in consulting, solution selling, and project delivery, he empowers organizations to transform through data and intelligence technologies. And Joris will now talk about how Azure data and AI can bring you more business value, and he will show some great examples. It's great to have you here, Joris, and please, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, and that's a great introduction. And let me quickly start sharing my screen because I think that makes sense. There we go, and here we go, I think. All right, so good morning, everyone. Indeed, I'm Joris Falconet, and I'm data and AI specialist at Microsoft. As mentioned, indeed, I have one customer, and that is Shell, so I focus only on Shell. And as data and AI specialist, I talk to the Microsoft clients about the value data and AI can bring and how to realize it, how to make it real. And that also comes with a lot of skills that you need to have to realize value. And as you can see in this picture, we just saw a very beautiful photo of myself speaking, and then you would wonder, why does he put up this, well, blurry kind of low resolution picture, and I will get into that in a bit. But when I look at skilling, let me start with skilling, because I think that's the predominant topic as well of today. That I went back 5 years ago, because I just I'm working for Microsoft for 5 years now, and 5 years ago I spent quite some time on my own learning and skilling. And back then we did not have a lot of programs and skills and things like that. But back then I started to buy some books and actually learned about Azure, basically. Azure machine learning, and I always had a passion for artificial intelligence, AI. I have a mathematical background even, so I always specialize in that one. So I did some reading of books, I did some exams, and then also I dove into what we call deep learning nowadays. And that's all great, but when you look at making it real, it's, I think, always great to do it. So after reading some books and getting familiar with the great things that Azure has to offer, I think, okay, let's start doing some practical things with it. And practical things can be doing a business POC, for example, when you want to do an IoT, build a small IoT solution. But in my free time, I also like to decorate my house, and sometimes I buy paintings. So I stumbled upon, when I was scrolling around, paintings, art, and AI, upon something that's called transfer learning. And what you see here is that there are some tutorials how to basically turn a picture into an artwork based on AI. So when I was learning about Azure and things like that, let's do a small pilot to for myself, just to learn to experiment. If I can also create a generated painting based on a picture and a piece of art. And surprisingly, with the skills that I've learned about Azure and some guidelines of tutorials, I was able to do so. And when you look at this, so within a couple of hours, I took my own picture. I took some paintings of Picasso and Rembrandt, because I think those are, of course, iconic paintings that are there. And based on the computing power of Azure with the latest AI technologies, I was able to generate my own painting based on Rembrandt and Picasso. And I think that's something that I learned within a few hours. And that is something that I never could have imagined 10 years ago that I was be able to do. And the Rembrandt picture that you see here is also the picture that you saw on the first slide. And I, so this I did 5 years ago, and until today I use these paintings that I basically generated with AI as my own avatar within Microsoft. So everybody in Microsoft, when they have a call with me, they see this picture, and then we have a great conversation on the value of what AI can bring. So in the coming, I think we have 40 minutes or a little bit less left. What I'd like to do is to show you three domains within the area of data and AI, where we have most conversations with our customers. I show you one example, and because I'd like to experiment, I will also try to do some demos that you can see how things work. And I will also explain how to get started and what you need to learn to make these solutions come to life and to realize the value that you can get out of it. And the first topic that I'd like to start with is something that pops up increasingly more. And we call that within Microsoft as a term, knowledge mining. But knowledge mining, what is that basically? So when you look at businesses today, and of course, there are many businesses out there, the majority still have lots of paperwork. Things are being sent as an invoice in a paper. Somebody writes a document. There has been a research paper. There is a permit to build something somewhere. There is an environmental kind of study being done upon which a decision needs to be made. So paperwork is all out there, whether that's physical paperwork like books, or that it is actually digital paperwork. And a lot of content is captured in these papers. And what you see is that knowledge workers, I think that's still the term that we use today, spend still quite some time on writing things down or reading documents and trying to get information out of that. So there is a lot of value captured in all these documents. But the good thing is AI can make these employees much more effective by doing some great things. So let me show you how you can capture information from these documents. So we all do whiteboarding. So for example, when we are doing whiteboarding, and then we used to do whiteboarding because that's more difficult nowadays, but I'm sure we will be in the future. But when you do physical whiteboarding, you get all these nice lines written down. And what we would usually do is take a picture of the whiteboard and then you share it via email. But of course you can extract with some AI, it's called OCR, optical character recognition, you can extract the text from these kind of whiteboards. And then you have the text digitally. Next to that, pictures are being made. And this is a personal picture of someone where there's a girl throwing a ball into a basket. But of course, there are many business-like pictures being taken of certain situations. You want to sell the house, you take a picture of the house, and then you post that somewhere, but of course there's information captured in this picture. And with some latest technologies, you can get the information out of the picture. So with text like throwing ball, girl, grass, basketball, and things like that. And of course, we have lots of forms out there. Everybody fills in forms, and information is captured in these forms. Sometimes people write this down with a pen, or something is it, this is then being digitally done, but also extract the entities and the data from these forms can now relatively easily being done by the latest AI technologies. So when on this low level, you can get information out of all these documents, and these are, of course, that can be books, but it can be pictures, that can be digital forms or what have you, many great things can happen. So basically what you do is all the documents that you have, you will scan those, extract the data, you will detect the language, you extract some entities like location. You will, based on all this data, build up a knowledge graph, so linking things together. In with that, you can effectively search for all kinds of relevant information that you are looking for. And this can really speed up the process of finding information. So let's make this real and show you a very short demo how Wolters Kluwer developed such a solution for some lawyers. And let me switch over and let me see how smoothly that goes. Here we go. So what you see here is an actual, this is a demo environment from Wolters Kluwer that they've built for lawyers. And in this case, it's United States lawyers who are interested in doing mergers, acquisitions, and those kind of financial transactions, basically, with companies. And they are in the context of, with merger acquisitions, they usually search for the position of these companies and the relationships based on public information from the Security and Exchange Commission. And in the Netherlands, we have similar organizations and similar scenarios, of course. But lawyers spend a lot of time reading all these documents, the legal clauses, trying to uncover if there is some due diligence that is not correct or some outliers that's out there. And with extraction from information, we can make things much easier. So in this case, we empower lawyers to do the work more effectively. So when we search, for example, for a public company, and my favorite company in this case is Microsoft, it's like a search experience that you have. And then when you search for that, what you see is that all different kind of documents have been analyzed. So you see here, this is a PDF. The first item is a PDF document. Then this is a picture of a PowerPoint slide. Then you see another PowerPoint slide. And in all these, Microsoft can be found. And sometimes you have to look for where is Microsoft actually captured. And in this case, it is there. And also what you see is that, for example, slides with logos, even then the name of the company can be extracted. So various types of information can be put on the fingertips of these lawyers and attorneys. But when you open such a document, suppose this is relevant, what you will actually see is the document itself and also the actual text that has been extracted. And in this case, it's a relatively straightforward PDF document, but also when things have been done in handwriting, this also works. And this is an American flavor of it, of an English text. But of course, if you have written this in Russian or Chinese, then also the text can be extracted and translated. The second step, when you have all this text available, what you can do is entity extraction. So for example, what you see here are some in the blue, some names of organizationals and people that have been identified, and in green, some key phrases that you should pay attention to. So without reading the document, you can immediately see some outliers there that could be of interest when you are doing your work. And this is basically a relatively simple solution where you can do all kinds of analysis. You can also do targeted search. So this is a search experience, which, for example, if you want to search for fraud and risk, when they are within 10 words of each other, if you search for these kind of scenarios, then you can have much more targeted search. And then also what you would see that there are some red flags being identified. And so some cybersecurity risks might be available with this certain company. So here you see that AI really makes the attorney in this case much more empowered to do their due diligence much more effective. Let me switch back to my slides. I should click this button there. So when you look at how this actually works, so this sounds like, hey, this is a Google-like or Bing-like experience, and this is a search thing, and how can I make that within my company? Because this is a tailored example for attorneys. Then actually it is not that hard to build this. So what you see here is an architecture that and the technologies that have been used to build this. So basically what you have is your documents, your data, you will apply some AI to the data to extract the information. Then you do some annotations, skill extractions. So basically you generate metadata, you put that in a search index, and then you can actually search. So and you see that we have Azure technologies that really help you to develop this in a short time frame. So for example, Azure Cognitive Services provides the skills that you need to extract the data, and Azure Cognitive Search makes the search index very, very effective. And we also have tutorials for this. So when, from a skilling perspective, you have done your Azure fundamentals, you started and you know how Azure works, there are huge amounts of accelerators and tutorials available, for example, in this case for knowledge mining, to build these kind of scenarios. And when I look at my own customer or customers basically in the Netherlands, but also beyond that, I see increasingly lots of transformational use cases specifically in this domain popping up. And you can think of course, finding legal clauses, which we just figured out, but also examples where people fill in forms and then they need to type it over into an Excel sheet, for example, or another application. But with these technologies to extract the data from documents, you can actually generate the input into the other applications. Other examples that are out there indeed is in the finance, to find kind of financial risks or payments that you need to do, which is captured in the documents, but not captured in your legacy or transactional systems. And there are many, many, many cases out there. Also in research and development. So if you have an R&D department where people read all these scientific papers to get a summarization out, for example, is also a typical way to find the right information that is relevant for you within your own organization. And these solutions are at your fingertips today and relatively easy to build. A second topic that I'd like to cover is, and I already just mentioned, cognitive services. So Azure Cognitive Services, this is basically Azure services that people can use to build all kinds of innovative AI solutions. But when we look at AI, the innovation has rapidly been really evolving quickly. And we usually compare that with human parity. And with human parity, we mean, so when I'm speaking, you are hearing what I'm saying, and I hope that I speak very clearly so that every word really comes across and that you really understand what I mean. But reality is that sometimes we get distracted, our hearing system, or I speak things slightly, pronounce it poorly, which leaves some mistakes in the translation, in the perception, things like that. And so we'd like to do always compare what AI can do compared to humans. Are we just as good as humans? And sometimes we can be better. And you see the achievements compared to humans in object recognition, speech recognition, reading, translation. We have had many achievements in the industry, and these are the Microsoft achievements in the industry for the last time. The latest, what you see in 2020, which is very interesting, is document summary, for example. So in the demo just I showed, you see some documents, you need to open the documents to actually see what's in there. But now we can very effectively summarize very large documents into a very small paragraph, which really helps in all kinds of cases. With all these state-of-the-art AI capabilities that are out there, we try to democratize those. And we democratize those through Azure Cognitive Services. So we call this is breakthrough AI within reach of organizations. And these are pre-trained models, if you like, that you can use within your own context, within your own environment. And it is, of course, of high quality. So it's built for a mission-critical environment. It is thoroughly tested, And of course, we take care of responsibility and ethics with that. And so there are, of course, some latest AI technologies out there, and we will not put that in our cognitive services because it's not within our ethical standards. But with the bundle of Azure Cognitive Services, you can use the latest and greatest of AI for all kinds of solutions within your organization. And technically, how this works is relatively easy for developers. So basically what you see here, there is a picture of some text being written. And if a developer uploads this document to the API of Azure Cognitive Services, you get a result. And the result is actually, hey, this is the text that has been written down in this small piece of paper. And this is actually the location where it has been written. And with this input, you can build great solutions. And what you see here is an example of what we call OCR, so optical character recognition. But there are many other capabilities that are out there. So when you look at the portfolio of cognitive services, you've just seen vision, so things that the human eye can observe in text extraction, image captures, form recognition, and things like that. Speech, so automatically translating my speech into text. And I did not prepare this, but I think I can turn that indeed on the spot. It starts subtitles. And then there you go. The speech automatically is being, my speech is being translated into the text beneath it. So this is a talk cognitive services basically in action. And I did not prepare for that. So let me also stop the subtitles or I get distracted. And what we see with speech, for example, for the European Union, where many politicians speak in their local language. So for example, if Merkel speaks towards the EU, she speaks in German. And then what we have a solution where her German talk is being interpreted, so turned into text, and then automatically being translated, for example, into Dutch and spoken out again into the Dutch language or English or French or Italian. So with these kind of solutions with speech, you can do many, many great things. Another example with speech is for logistic companies. Sometimes you have drivers that go from, for example, the Netherlands, drive to Italy. And when they arrive at their destination, something has changed locally. So the drop-off location has changed. There are some issues with forms and things like that. And of course, drivers don't always speak the native language. And then you get into difficult situations where things are lost in translation and there is a lot of things that needs to happen. So we have solutions where there is an app where you can basically speak in your own language. Hey, I need to drop off this package. But I see this building has empty, and then you call a local contact point, which actually hears your text into the local language. For example, you speak in Dutch, it will be the person hears it in Italian. They speak back in Italian, and you hear things back in Dutch. And this is much more effective than figuring out things on the spot or having to contact your headquarters and things get lost in translation and in procedures, for example. So speech is a really interesting area. Language, we have just seen an example of a language solution with all kinds of entity extractions from text, intent, understanding where we have identified risks. So there are a lot of language solutions that you can build. And also in the area of decision making, I think an interesting one is the personalization part. So next best offer kind of engines, you can just use an API and get solutions very personalized rapidly, easily. So if we look at zoom in into vision, because I think that's a very great example, you can also bring your own scenarios. So what you see here is an example of a manufacturer that wants to inspect pieces of equipment, and sometimes equipment is broken. And then you send out an expert that looks at the equipment and they make an assessment. But of course, if you have a solution that can just make a photo of a piece of equipment, or even have a camera that constantly monitors, with some AI solutions, you can detect things that are being broken. And this sounds like a very complicated solution to build, because you have to develop these AI models, because these are very specific to the equipment potentially, and it is very fine-grained, things like that. But making these is not that difficult nowadays. And let me briefly show you how that works. And people can very easily learn this. So we have a website that's called customvision.ai, which is part of the Azure Cognitive Services. So it's a website where you sign in. And when you sign in, what you basically can do is create new projects. So a project is defect detection, for example. And what we want to do is detect kind of defects, and then you can do some configurations. And when you have created a project, you see an example where I tried to build a detection algorithm or model for detecting the switches in my own electrical switch box. So you upload basically your pictures, and what you then do in this user interface, you just drag and drop, and you say this is a switch, and here you can say, okay, here it is a number. Very simple, you can just tag the defects based on, if you want to do defect detection based on some images that you might have. You click on a button that's called train, and you can say, I want to do it very advanced, and it needs to be very good, or do it very quickly. You click on the button, and then all kinds of magics is happening behind the scenes. And this technology, which is relatively easy, provides a lot of value in the innovation space. And we see a lot of new kinds of solutions and optimization. Usually these are cost reduction kind of cases that you want to achieve with that. These are quite popular nowadays, because it's so easy to build the real state-of-the-art AI into it. And let me switch back. Another example are the things that you can do with video. So this is a cognitive service called spatial analysis, where in shops you want to make sure that the people keep their distance in the case of COVID. And what you see here, this API of cognitive services can measure the distance between people, such that if they are too close together, or if there are too many people within a confined space, that you get an alert that you can warn the people to keep their distance, for example. And this is a very specific COVID example, but the same kind of distance analysis you can do, for example, with product placement, or there are many things that you can do in the area of safety. And this is not that hard to develop, because the measuring of the distance is just out of the box there. And when you have some skills with development, it's very easy to make these. And of course, after you did your introductory courses, it's not that hard to develop these, because there are a lot of tutorials available on the Microsoft website with example applications that you then can extend. So building it is not that hard. So we've covered knowledge mining, doing great things with documents. Here specifically on how to do things with cognitive services with vision. And the third item, I think, is the most impactful and more strategic, is what we at Microsoft call cloud scale analytics. Practically, usually we talk about data lakes, but cloud scale analytics is the term that we use within Microsoft. And this is fundamental to what we call digital transformations. And I'm not here to talk about the impact of digital transformation. And I think you guys have heard about the economic impact and things like that. But when you make things practical, digital transformation, in my mind, is usually to break through the boundaries that are out there in organizations. And in the organizations, we have usually a couple of lenses how we look at things. So you have your customers, You have your own operations, products, and employees. And for example, in the healthcare systems, your customers are your patients that can become sick, or hopefully they are healthy, and your employees are your doctors. And for example, if you have somebody that has a condition with some signals, a patient can indicate whether they are feeling great or that there is something wrong by giving some feedback in an app, or where they have, for example, an IoT device measuring their heartbeat, as an example. And when this information flows into a centralized environment where you can securely and taking privacy into account, of course, but you can analyze the data. And when a doctor looks at this information and determines that it would be good that this patient comes to the clinic to do some analysis and to do some diagnostics on the patients, because the patient automatically sent out his information to the central environment, the doctor makes a recommendation. You can, because the data is stored centrally, make sure that the clinic creates the operation, and that some equipment that might be needed for analyzing the patients are being reserved in the system, like an RMI system, for example. So combining the data is fundamental to become more efficient and go through digital transformations. So from a technical perspective, what we usually say, it would be great to have one common data platform where the data is going to be residing in the single source of truth, if you like, with a common data model, such that things can communicate. And what you see here is a schematic where you, for example, have some IoT solutions measuring a heartbeat from a patient or a piece of equipment, some applications being hosted, and all the data is being stored in a centralized environment. And because the data is being stored in a centralized environment, you can do some analytics AI based on that to get recommendations, but you can also create low-code, no-code apps with the Power Platform, Power Apps, for example, such that a doctor can create a very simple app to do some work more effectively than they have to use standard procedures or with paper. And this can all be done because the data is accessible on the same location. And when you do that in the right way, things get accessible very easily. So let me give you a very simple example in the analytics space. And let me switch back. When we look at analytics, of course, and I hope most of you know, Power BI is, of course, the environment where you can do interactive analysis. So when the data is stored in this centralized location within Power BI, you can analyze the data. And what we see here is a report for a sales organization. So when you are a salesperson, you always look at your pipeline, whether you have sufficient clients, you have sufficient opportunities, and you can analyze what your pipeline is looking for. And this is a dashboard for executive management where they can drill down into certain specifics. But of course, when I am a single salesperson, I am not interested to look at the full big picture of my organization. I want to understand what is happening for my typical client. And then when these dashboards have been created, it's nice, but it does not give me the right information that I need. But because the data is stored on this centralized environment and I have access to it in a secure manner, I can also build my own reports. Of course, I need to do some skilling training, how Power BI works, for example, in this case. But what you see here is the data sets that have been made available to me. So for example, when I'm looking at what is happening within my own customer, I will look at the sales data. And then because I have access to the data set, I can do my own analysis by creating a report. So I want to know what accounts I have and also what the revenue has been with these accounts very easily. And let's make it in a nice graph. Next to that, I also want to understand, so these are my accounts, what products I have sold. So we have the products and then the revenue that comes with that. And here you see my customers and of course the products. And with that, I can see, okay, what has this typical account being, what did they buy for me? And then you can see they did a lot of, it's a bit small, but a lot of pillows. This is a retail example. And this other account of mine did a lot of cocktail glasses. But when I look at this data, I'm always wondering, okay, so I'm a salesperson, but what makes these data that they buy this data? So what I can do very easily is analyze the data here and to find the distribution. So what makes this account stand apart? So with a few clicks, I can let the data being analyzed for me. And then when the data is being analyzed, and this usually takes only a few seconds, then we can very easily see the outliers. And oh yeah, there we go. And here you see some outliers, and let's not dive into why this is the case, but I think the message is it's very easy. Something else that I, as a salesperson, is interested in. So what are my next best offers that I should offer to my customers? And I want to have this personalized. So one account, I want to offer something else than another account, for example. And of course, since I'm not real tech savvy, so this is within my reach of doing and within my interest, because I can see my own accounts. But I, of course, like to go into the machine learning part of it for next best offers. And then most organizations have data scientists that can empower me to find the next best offer kind of scenario. So for data scientists, when I collaborate with a data scientist, these usually wants to work in other technologies. So since the data has been stored on a centralized environment, we can give data scientists access to Azure Machine Learning Services. I should go here. So what you see here is Azure Machine Learning Services, which is connected to the same storage layer. And within this environment, data scientists can do all kinds of analysis. Of course, we need access to the data. And when you look at the data that is available, we see here that sales data have been made available to me as a data scientist. So when I click on the sales data, what you can see is actually the data set is being made available to me, where you see all the accounts and the products that have been sold to these accounts. And this can be a great starting point to build a next best offer kind of recommendation engine. But the table is not sufficient. I need to build a model with that. And when you build a model, if you are tech savvy as a data scientist, you would like to really use Python. And so what you see here is actually Python code that you can use to build this model. So when you copy that very easily, there are what we call notebooks available where you can basically start developing your code as a data scientist. And then based on that, you can build your AI model, which is a very relatively easy way of coming to these kind of analytics, where everybody is looking at the same data. So having centralized storage is something that is quite important there. And then when you look at from a technology perspective, this is a data platform, so it's bigger than a small solution, but this is these are the architectures that come with that. So when we see people being skilled in what we call modern data warehousing or data lakes, they need to learn all kinds of Azure solutions to build up these very powerful data platforms which really empower organizations to do the right analysis and also collaborate more effectively, because you have a single storage layer where finance, HR, operations, sales have stored their data. The principle for these data platforms is basically very simple. You have all kinds of data sources within your organization, external, you ingest the data. So Azure Data Factory is one of the Azure services that facilitates that. You store that on the centralized storage, Azure Data Lake Store is that. And then you have all kinds of transformations that you would do. We have just seen a glimpse of Azure Machine Learning Services. So that's the environment where data scientists work with Python code is hip and happening nowadays. But also there are other languages like R. And when you look at universities, the latest students really learn these languages. So when you have starters, they actually can use these technologies very easily. Azure Databricks is for big data processing, big data analysis, which is based on Spark technologies, which is becoming the standard in data processing nowadays. And then with Azure Synapse Analytics, that's really your foundational store where you store the data for analysis. And then we have seen Power BI for the end users to really make things come to life for them. So what you see here are all kinds of Azure technologies that when you do trainings, these technologies you actually will learn how to use. And when you do that, it's really powerful for all kinds of transformational stories. And when I was looking at who is using this, and I know a lot of organizations are using this, but also is Microsoft internally using this? And the answer is yes. So all Microsoft transformational stories, they all have the foundation of this centralized data platform where all the data is becoming the standard for all kinds of applications, analytics. So it's the foundation of the digital transformation. And we have great stories how Microsoft's finance has been changed with a few data scientists to become actually a business partner. So Microsoft Finance is approaching me on a regular basis. Hey, we have found these insights based on our financial data that empower you to have more meaningful conversations with your customers. And so, and they are empowered to do so because they have learned how to work with Azure Machine Learning Services, with Power BI, and because there is this centralized data platform that made it happen. The same story goes for the Microsoft supply chain. And Microsoft supply chain sounds maybe, why does Microsoft have a supply chain? Because you are a tech company. But of course, we ship many devices. When you look at service books, Xbox, all these HoloLenses and things like that, it's a really big organization that deals with many manufacturers across the globe, usually from the East in Asia and also in the United States and Mexico. And then you have customers across the globe. And how to bring these products, assemble them, and bring them in time to the retail stores or delivered to people at home is a quite complicated global challenge. And they have transformed completely in the same way where they have built a standardized data platform where all the data is flowing in from the Microsoft itself, the sales department, but also the suppliers that come with that. So it's that there is one place where people can collaborate to streamline the supply chain. So here as well, having the skills to build these platforms is fundamental to the transformation that happened. And when you look at the data trainings, there are many of those, and I think these are the ones that I had to do myself. So data engineering, so then you really know what kind of data technologies are there. And when you do these, you actually can build these data platforms, these Power BI way of working with the machine learning very effectively based on Azure technologies. And there are many kind of tutorials how to do very state-of-the-art kind of scenarios. Here you see one which is Azure Cosmos DB, which is a very powerful globally rolled out database with low latency, and it's become quite technical, but real-time analytics on apps that are out there. So these tutorials really help when you have a business idea to realize that on the short term, because the steps to get started are there for you to grab. And with that, I've briefly shared some examples about how to build solutions with knowledge mining, so documents, some examples how easy it is to build the state of the art or use the state of the art AI in applications, And the fundamental piece with that is building out your data platforms and having the skills to do so. That's one of the important things that I've shared. And I hope that you all enjoyed this. And I might have a second or two for a question, if there is a question.